So once again, good afternoon to those who have joined in. So today we are going to start with a new concept in the bridge course, which is your introduction to calculus. Okay. Graphs and all, even though there are many other graphs to be done, many other function relation graph to be plotted, we are going to take that once we reopen after your board exams happen. Okay. So don't worry about missing anything, even though your assignment worksheet says so many different functions, right? You would be seeing some square bracket, some curly bracket type of thing, log, exponential, max, min. So we'll be taking that up later on. Don't worry about it. There's nothing like we're going to skip, because all those are very, very integral part of your learning in mathematics. So Setu says, is this a class on Friday, physics, because we have exam on Saturday? No, you will not have an exam, not have a class on Friday. I think sir will drop you a message a day before. I kept this class because Koramangala people, your next exam is on 3rd of April. So you have enough time. So you have 2 days left for that. So that's why we kept the class. So sir, so about classes are over till boards. AB classes, I didn't get that. Oh, you wrote that in Hindi. Yes, kind of. Because most of you are going to start with your board exams in the first week of May. So it would be over mostly. Okay. So today we are going to start with introduction to calculus. Calculus. Now, most of you would have heard of this term. Calculus, maybe from your seniors, maybe from your elder brothers or sisters, right? Or maybe people talking around you, okay? And some of the students who were there with us in the accelerator program last year, Tushar sir would have definitely taken you through calculus, a bit of calculus at least. So calculus is something which has been a buzzword in mathematics, okay? And rightly so, because it is one of the major breakthroughs in the field of mathematics. Calculus, personally, I feel that this branch of mathematics was actually invented. Okay. So see, when mathematics was evolving, okay, it evolved from geometry. So geometry was the first field of mathematics that most of us, in fact, the entire world studied geometry. So we talked about shapes, circles, triangles, right? So even a small child who starts learning mathematics, he starts his mathematical journey with shapes, right? My daughter, who's just 4.5 years, she's been taught about what's a circle, what's a triangle, and all those stuff, correct? So later when math evolved, from geometry, we went to algebra, where we started talking about numbers, we started talking about equations and all those algebraic operations. And then we started moving towards analytical geometry, what we know as the coordinate geometry. So our first chapter of the bridge course, where we learned about graphs and its transformations, it was basically based on analytical geometry. Now, calculus is a very, very new field of mathematics, even though it was invented in the 17th century by two famous scientists, okay, independently of each other. So it was invented by Isaac Newton and Gottfried Wilhelm Leibniz. I'll just write his last name. It is a big name. This guy is a German guy. So Newton, everybody knows, right? He has been very instrumental in the field of gravitation, in the field of optics. Leibniz is a German guy, Gottfried Wilhelm Leibniz, who actually independently, invented calculus. Actually, Leibniz was accused of plagiarism by Newton. But later on, it was proved wrong. It was basically found out that Leibniz had almost in the very same time frame came up with the same set of ideas which actually Newton had developed. Now I'll just go into a brief history about calculus, because it's very interesting for you to know that calculus actually comes from a Latin word calculi. Okay, calculi is basically a word for pebbles. Pebbles were used for counting. Okay, so calculus was developed, or calculus was invented, when a rich astronomist by the name of Edmund Halley. he visited Newton, and he said Newton was at that time a well-renowned figure. So Edmund Halley, who was a very rich guy, he said, he asked Newton to work upon the gravitation force between two celestial bodies. So two planetary bodies, he asked him to make a study about it. Okay. So what he said was, what he asked Newton to do. So let's say there are two celestial bodies. So I'm just making one with red, other with yellow. Okay. And let's say between these two celestial bodies, the distance is R. Okay. The distance is R. Now, of course, we all know that there is a force of attraction between two celestial bodies, correct? So Edmund Halley wanted Newton to work on how does this force change when the distance between the two celestial bodies changes. Okay, so let's say now it is R, and let's say it becomes R plus delta R. Okay, delta R is basically to signify the change in the distance. So what is this, what impact does it bring on the force of attraction between the two bodies? So let's say because of the change in R to R plus delta R, the force of attraction is also going to change, isn't it? So if the bodies are going to go faster and go away from each other, the force of attraction will reduce. If they come closer, the force of attraction will increase, correct? So he wanted him to study how does the force of attraction change with respect to change in the distance. Okay. And when this change is very, very small, okay, right now I have used a symbol over here, delta R, and I put an arrow and zero. Okay. So when he approached Newton to make a study of this, okay, he wanted him to tell him how does infinitesimal change in the distance between their centers bring about a change in the gravitational force between the two bodies. Okay, so a quantity which is very small like this, there is a new word that you will get to learn today, and that word is infinitesimal. Infinitesimal. Infinitesimal is basically made up of two words, infinite plus small. So infinite and small, if you combine, it becomes infinitesimal. So understand this. So basically, Edmund Halley, I think Halley word you would have heard of before. Has anybody heard of the word Halley before? Let me check your geography skills. Halley word, anybody has heard of it? Halley's Comet, exactly. Arjun Ramesh, sir, is this class for NPS Indranagar? No, dear, it is not for Indranagar. Have people from Indranagar also joined in? Anybody from Indranagar has also joined in? I don't think so. This message was sent to Indranagar. So Arjun, how did you enter this session? Okay. So no, this is not for Indranagar. Indranagar session will happen independently. But if you want to be a part of the session, you're most welcome, Arjun. Okay. Okay. So any Indranagar student who has joined in this session, you are most welcome to stay in the session. Okay. Yeah, because you also missed a class because you had exams going on. So if you want to be a part of this session, you can be there. But yes, the same thing will be repeated again for your batch as well once your exams are done. Okay. Anyways, let's continue. All right. So now this branch of mathematics, as it suggests from this simple example, is basically deals with quantities which are changing continuously. That means there is an infinitesimal change in the quantities. How does it affect another quantity related to it? So here, what was the case? Basically, here was a case where one quantity, which is your force, is related to the distance between the bodies. So how does this force change if there is a small change in R? That is what calculus helps us to figure out. Okay, so many people say, sir, what is the role of calculus here? So calculus is nothing but it's a field of mathematics. It's a vertical of mathematics, which helps you to understand how does one quantity change with respect to another when there is a very, very small change, infinitesimal change, or there is a very continuous change happening in the other. Correct? So see, these two bodies, right, because of their rotation, revolution, whatever, the distance between them will gradually change, right? It doesn't happen like abruptly, right? It is a gradual change. So, right, if it is gradually changing, how does the force between them changes? That is what calculus helps us to figure out. Okay. So in plain and simple words, if you ask me, what does calculus help us to study? Calculus is basically a branch which helps us to study continuous changes in variables. Okay. This term, later on, you would be learning, it is called df by dr. This is what will be called as df by dr, where this d stands for differential. Differential. Differential means a change which is as good as zero change, almost zero change. Aryan, sir, my third pre-board got over today, so can I send my homework by tomorrow? Yeah, Aryan, don't worry about homework. Okay. Okay, yeah. Okay, now for God's sake, please do not cancel off DD. Okay, D here stands for differential change. So Newton was very influential towards what we call as differential calculus. So this will be studied under, this part of calculus would be studied under differential calculus. Differential calculus. So are there different verticals of calculus as well? Yes. What you know is just, you know, the broader version of calculus. So Newton was effectively working on something called differential calculus. So he wrote a book called Method of Fluxions. Okay. This fluxions word later on was renamed to derivatives. Okay. Derivative is something which comes out from the process of differentiation. Okay, so not a lot of new words coming your way, especially for people who have not heard about it. So Newton, just understand as of now that Newton was effectively working on differential calculus. Okay, differential calculus is where we deal with derivatives. What is derivative? We'll talk about it later on. Don't worry about it right now. Okay, Leibniz, on the other hand, was instrumental towards working on integral calculus. Okay. So he worked on integration mainly. Okay, he worked on integration part. But both of them basically worked on calculus together. And whatever they worked on, they are basically linked to each other. Okay, and these two are linked to each other. So they are linked by fundamental theorem of calculus. Fundamental theorem of calculus. What is it? Don't worry about that now. Just understand that Newton was working on differential calculus, Leibniz was working on integral calculus, and both these fields of calculus are linked to each other by a theorem called fundamental theorem of calculus. Okay, what is the details of these small concepts which I have given to you? We will talk about it in some time. Don't worry about it. Okay, so by this time you should have understood who invented calculus, correct? It was independently done by Newton and Leibniz. And what is this calculus actually trying to study? So I'm just giving you one example of it. So here probably I give you one differential calculus example. Let me give you more examples. So let us understand why calculus becomes so important in the field of maths, physics, and chemistry, which all the three are going to study this year. So let us understand what is the use of calculus. Okay. So few examples just to understand what is the use of calculus for us. Okay. Now let me give you a simple example just to illustrate what is the use of calculus. Let's say you are going from Bangalore to Mysore on your car. Okay, so let's say along the y-axis, we plot the displacement of your car and on the x-axis we plot the time taken by your car. Okay, so let's say you started your journey, or let me put it over here. You started your journey at t equal to 0, and here you are at Bangalore. Okay, so at t equal to 0, when you started your journey, you are at Bangalore. Okay, and let's say by t equal to 5, you reached Mysore. Okay, and Mysore is, let's say, here. And the journey of your car looks like this. Yeah, okay. So by this time, you reach your destination, which is Mysore. Okay, and let's say Mysore to Bangalore, this distance is about 150 kilometers. Okay, and you took 5 hours. Let's say this time is in hours and the displacement is in kilometers. Now let me ask you a simple question. What is the average speed of your car? What is the average speed of your car? Who will tell me? A bit of physics I am asking you over here. Exactly, Sharduli. Exactly. I think nobody has any doubt. Karthik, absolutely correct. So basically what you did, you basically took total change in the displacement by total change in the time. Right? So what was the change in the displacement? 150 kilometers, correct? So from Bangalore to Mysore, the change in the displacement that happened was 150 kilometers. What was the change in the time? Change in time was 5 hours, correct? So when you divide 150 kilometers by 5 hours, you get your answer as 30 kilometers per hour. Okay, this is what we call as the average speed of the car. Okay, nobody has any doubt in that. Any doubt? Okay, now let us say I ask you another question on the same. Look at this graph. Look at this graph. Using this graph, tell me what was the speed of your car at t equal to 3 hours? What was the speed of your car at t equal to 3? Many of you would be like, what? Just at that t equal to 3, what is the speed you are asking? Because see, many people are baffled by this question. Many people are shocked by this question because I have not mentioned any time interval of travel. I'm asking you at a pinpoint time at t equal to 3. Let's say you started your journey at 12 noon. So when the clock struck 3 p.m., let's say you are somewhere here on your journey, correct? So this is, let's say, t equal to 3. Now here, if I ask you, at this instant of time, what was the speed of your car? How will you solve this question? What will that give you, Ashnav, if you draw perpendiculars on the x-axis and the y-axis? How does it help you? Doesn't give, right? Yes. Right? Now, I don't see any answer coming from any one of you because we have never... No. we can't say close to this. Okay? So now, Sharduli is saying, okay, let's allow the car to move for 2 seconds and then we'll see how much distance it covered or how much displacement it had. Okay, so you take the displacement divided by 2 seconds. But why 2 seconds? It will be giving you the average velocity between 3 hours, 2 seconds. Right? But why 2 seconds? Why not 1 second? Why not 0.1 second? Why not 0.001 second? Why not 1.00? Why are you allowing the car to move for 2 seconds? 2 seconds may be a very large time. Correct. Now you have to allow your car to move for an infinitesimal time. That is the concept that you are basically trying to apply over here, right? The word infinitesimal, the moment it comes, basically calculus will jump at that instant of time, isn't it? So here, what are you doing in order to know what is the speed of the car? At t equal to 3, you need to allow the car to run for a very small time, and that time is almost tending to 0. And you are trying to see what is the displacement of the car in that point of time. Are you getting my point? So, in the neighborhood of t equal to 3, you have to allow the car to move for a very, very small magnitude or very, very small, time duration, which is what we call as infinitesimal time duration. And you need to check what is the displacement in that time. And this will give you the velocity of the car at t equal to 3. Now, such concepts here is what we call as finding the differential or finding the derivative of the displacement with respect to time at t equal to 3. As you can see, calculus has featured over here. This is what we call as instantaneous speed. Okay, so whenever instantaneous concepts come into picture, calculus has to be used. Are you getting my point? So we cannot solve this question till we know what's the use of, what is the calculus here. Okay, so calculus basically will help you to know that at this instant of time, what is the velocity. I'm not asking you what is the displacement at that time. Okay, I'm asking you what is the velocity at that time. Okay, are you getting my point? Later on, we will learn that the velocity can be obtained by knowing the slope of the tangent at this point. So if you sketch a tangent to this curve, okay, this tangent will give you, let me write it down, the slope here will give you the velocity or speed, instantaneous speed at t equal to 3. Okay, now how? We will answer this little later on. Don't worry about it. Okay. So now this is just one example. So here you would see that we are primarily using differential calculus. So can I give some example where integral calculus will be used? So let me give you another instance. So let's say I ask you this question. There is a line segment which is connecting two points A, whose coordinate is x1, y1, and B, whose coordinate is x2, y2. Okay. Tell me, what is this distance AB? What is this distance AB? Siddharth has a question. Sir, if the speed of the car changes in time, how can we find the speed? See, speed of the car is changing every instant. So I'm asking you exactly when t was 3, what was the velocity or what was the speed of the car? At that instant. At a particular instant, it will have one speed, right? Siddharth? Okay, so I'm looking for that speed. Right, most of you have given the answer to this. The answer to this is x2 minus x1 or x1 minus x2 whole square, doesn't matter because you are squaring the stuff. Okay. Now, how do you get this formula? By Pythagoras theorem, right? So basically, geometry was sufficient for you to know the answer for this. So what do you normally do is, you consider that there was a coordinate axis. I'll just make a small coordinate axis over here. So let's say this was a coordinate axis for you, your y-axis and your x-axis. Okay. So here, I normally make a line parallel to the x-axis and I make this line parallel to the y-axis. Okay. Now, when you're moving along a line which is parallel to the x-axis, remember y-coordinate will not change. So this point C, y-coordinate will be y1. Okay, and if you move along a vertical line, x coordinate doesn't change. So here your coordinate will be x2, right? Abscissa will be x2. So AC distance, you can all easily figure out, is mod x2 minus x1. BC distance, you can easily figure out, is mod y2 minus y1. Okay, and you basically know your Pythagoras theorem that AB square is equal to AC square plus BC square. AC square plus BC square. And from here, you end up getting x2 minus x1 mod square. Remember, squaring will just take off that mod thing. You don't require a mod there. And this is your AB square. So if you just remove the square by taking a square root, there you get the distance. So here, geometry was sufficient for you to find the answer, correct? All you required was your Pythagoras theorem. But what if I change my question to this? So there is a curve, okay, which looks like this. Okay, so this is some curve which I know y is equal to r of x or f of x, whatever you want to call it. Correct. So tell me, what is the length of this curvilinear line? Curvilinear means it is a curve kind of a, you know, line. Okay. So what is this distance? How will you find out? How will you find out? See, we all have visited Bangalore. Bangalore is like, you can say, a city of flyovers, right? So there are some flyovers. I visited one of the flyovers in Indiranagar. It was like this, like this. How do I, of course, I can go with a string around the flyover and get the length of the string. But let's say if I know the equation of this, you know, path, can I get the length of this path? Can I get the length of this line segment? But will it be accurate, Sharduli? That's my question. Won't there be glitches? Won't there be, you know, errors coming into your answer? Right? There would be. So how do I find exact answers to these particular situations? Because the line segments which you are using, it should be infinitesimally small, small line segments, isn't it? Yes or no? And you are accumulating those line segments to know what is the length of this particular path from A to B. Now, the word infinitesimal has come again here, correct? And you are accumulating it to get the entire length of the line segment AB. Now, the word accumulating is basically linked to integral calculus, okay? So, the answer to this, I'll just write it down. But don't expect me to give you an explanation for it right now because you're not aware of the basics. So, just to give you an idea. The answer for this would be, let's say this is your x equal to A and this point is x equal to B point, okay? The answer to the length of line segment AB would be integration of under root of 1 plus derivative of r with respect to x whole square into dx integrated from A to B. Okay, now don't worry. This is like, you know, it went above your head. I understand that. it went tangentially, you know, across your, you know, head. But don't worry about it. We will talk about it later on in more detail. What I wanted to explain here was, what was my main aim of writing such thing is what? Here you are using integral calculus. Okay. And this symbol, you are going to see a lot. This symbol, the snake. Okay. By the way, let me tell you some... a small story about this snake. This snake was actually, it's a symbol for integration. It's a symbol for integration. Okay. This was invented by, this symbol was given to us by Leibniz. Okay. So Leibniz was the one who gave us this symbol. This symbol is actually a elongated S in long. Gated S, where S basically stands for summation. This is X, my dear. But don't worry about it, Setu, right now, because even if you note down the expression, you don't know how it comes actually. Okay. So for that, we have to understand calculus in more depth. Anyways, so this guy, see, what are you doing? You're doing accumulation, correct? You are accumulating the length of those small line segments, what Sharduli was talking about, right? So the art of accumulating these small changes is what is actually done by integral calculus. So what does differential calculus do then? Differential calculus studies the change in a quantity with respect to another when that another quantity is changing very, very minutely or very, very infinitesimally or very, very, you know, continuously. Are you getting my point? So just remember the example of Newton working on how does the gravitational force between the two planetary bodies change with respect to their small changes in the displacement. So when he's studying that, he's basically studying df by dr, which is a part of differential calculus. Whereas our friend Leibniz was working on accumulative calculus. Okay, where you are trying to add those small changes to make up a big quantity. Okay, so integration, the word itself, literal meaning of the word integration means combining, adding, right? Isn't it? Isn't it? The integration means that. So when we start combining these small quantities to give large to a bigger quantity, we are basically performing the operation of integration. Earth. What is earth? Earth is an integration of dust particles. Correct? So when dust particles accumulate, we basically get our earth. Correct? Isn't it? So all you need to understand from this example is that you will not be able to find answers to such questions without knowing calculus. Correct? Let me give you one more example. Let's say I ask you this question. There is a curve, or there is a, let's say, a straight line like this. Where is my white marker? White. Yeah. So let's say there is a straight line like this. Okay. So this line is basically y is equal to a line. Fine. Now, let's say this is x equal to 0. And this point is x equal to b. Correct? Can you tell me what is the area which is trapped between the x-axis and this line? I'm sure you would not even take a second to answer this. Right? There you go. I'm getting the answers AB. Absolutely. Right? Because all you could figure out here was it's a rectangle with length as B, height as or width as A, and you basically multiplied your length and width and got your answer. But what if I change this question slightly? Now let's say instead of having a line, straight line like this, your line was something like this. Okay, right? But you knew what was this function. Let's say this function or this relation is known to you. Now tell me, actually I made it very long. Okay, now tell me, what do you think is the area trapped between this curve and the x-axis between 0 to b? What is this area? Now, I'm sure you would be scratching your head. How do I do this? Correct? Right? Yes or no? But let me tell you, the answer to this is integration of the function multiplied with dx from 0 to b. This gives you the area. Okay? Now, just to give you a brief idea, how does this come out? So what do we do normally? We at a distance of x, okay, we consider a small differential change in x, which is called dx. Correct? Now, this height which you have taken at a distance of x, this height will be your f of x. So what do? We construct a thin rectangle over here. A rectangle like this. There you can see a rectangle being framed. Okay. So roughly speaking, this is a rectangular structure which we are making over here. Let me just shade it. Okay. Now this rectangle will have an area of f of x into d of x. Correct? So to know the full area, you have to keep adding these small area. Correct? So this kind of area, the strip area, you need to keep adding from 0 all the way till b. So that is what is written by integration from 0 to b. Integration means you're summing it up from 0 to b. So when you keep, see, if you take a cloth, let's say a handkerchief. A handkerchief is basically what? It is made up of, you know, threads, isn't it? So let's say this thin strip is like one of the threads of that handkerchief. So when you add all those thread areas, basically it gives you the area of the full handkerchief, right? So that is what here we are doing precisely. So this strip that you see, you can treat it as if it is a thread in your handkerchief, and you are trying to add all the areas of those thread to make a area of the handkerchief. So again, you are using accumulative calculus, which is what is done by integral calculus. Okay, how to do this process? Again, we will take it up later on. Don't worry about it. Sharduli has a question. So do we have to take the middle area, or we can take smaller triangles at the beginning? See, this is just, what did I say? At any distance x, you are taking this. Just because it is looking in the middle, it is not in the middle. Get the point. At any distance x. So basically, what you're doing, in general, you are going at a distance x, picking up a strip. You're finding the area of that strip. And you're adding all the way from 0 till the end where you need it. Okay? So it is not in the middle. Though it is looking like that, it is not in the middle. Got it? Okay. So let us begin the process of learning. Now that we have known why calculus is important, let us start learning it. Okay? So whatever processes I have explained you, though they were tangential to you as of now, we will try to understand them to depth, whatever time permits us. Okay. Now, let me tell you, calculus is something which you will immediately need in physics, not in maths. Maths, it will be taken up in your school middle of the session, probably. Let's say if your session starts in the June, July, August, September, October time frame, it will be taken up. But in physics, you're going to start with calculus, I think from the second or third class, right after your units and dimensions. The moment your teacher starts kinematics for you, you will have to use calculus. Okay. And let me tell you, in most of the cases, physics teachers do not go into details of calculus because they are mostly interested in their application part. Okay, so as a math teacher, it becomes my duty, it's my responsibility to make you aware of these nuances which you are going to face sooner or later, sooner in physics, later in maths. Sir, in chemistry, is it also used? Somebody is asking. Yes, in chemistry also it is used when you are studying chapters like chemical kinetics, right? So in chemical kinetics, when you are studying about the order of a reaction, you will be studying calculus there as well. You will be using calculus there as well. Okay. So many uses of calculus. The other day, I met a student. I just wanted to share this story with you. The student said that, sir, the student is in class 10th right now. And in class 11th, he wants to drop maths. Okay. Probably he has got some kind of brainwashing from his senior that math is difficult, though it is nothing like that. So he said, I want to drop math, sir. I said, why you want to drop math? Because almost every field needs it nowadays. No, sir, I want to do economics, right? So math is not required there. I said, who told you in economics math is not required? Economics is full of how one quantity changes with respect to other. And that is differential calculus, correct? Let's say you are a person, you are an IAS officer, let's say. Okay. You are into the decision-making, body of the government. You want to know how does the price of rice gets changed when there is a 1 paise change in the price of diesel or kerosene. You have to apply differential calculus there. Isn't it? So an economist needs calculus more than anybody else. Right? So please note, do not be under this impression that economics and other fields of maths do not need calculus. Calculus is, you can say, omnipresent. It is present almost in every field of maths. Commerce students have to study calculus. Forget about science students. Science students have to study calculus, no doubt. Commerce students also have to study calculus. Okay, commerce student, people who are planning to do economics, they have to study. Even in certain fields of maths, non-science subjects also calculus comes into picture, right? So please try to understand how important is this for you, all of you. And in your class, I'll just give you a brief idea about calculus breakup for you. So in our class 11th and 12th, what happened to my board? Yeah. Calculus overview. So I'll just tell you, in calculus, you have to study, as I already told you, you have to study two branches of calculus. One is called differential calculus. Okay. And other is what we call as the integral calculus. Okay. I'm just talking from your class 11th and 12th point of view. In 11th, you will be basically talking about only differential calculus. Okay. Even though in physics, you will be talking about integral calculus also. But in maths, I'm talking about, you're going to start your differential calculus with the idea of limits. Okay. So today we are going to discuss limits with you. Then you're going to talk about differentiation. So differentiation is actually a process by which we find derivatives. Okay. So what is differentiation? What is derivative? All those things will be covered under this part. Now, limits is totally in your class 11th, whereas differentiation is there in 11th as well as in 12th. More in 12th, less in 11th. 11th, you can actually treat it like an introduction. So you can treat it as an intro in class 11th. Okay. In class 12th, you will be like going into details of it. Okay. Right now, your 12th grade seniors have started with differentiation for them. So they are studying differentiation. In class 12th, you are going to be introduced to integral calculus. So under integral calculus, there are two types of integral calculus we are going to talk about. One is called indefinite integration. Indefinite integration. And the other one is definite integration. Now, what is the difference between them? We will discuss when we start these concepts with you. In the bridge course only, I will try to talk about them if time permits. And both these topics are pretty challenging. I will not use the word difficult. It's challenging, right? Especially the first one, this guy. This is very, very practice intensive topic. I recall my class 12th summer vacation. So normally summer vacations are normally for 40 days, 40 odd days. Full 40 days I practiced integrations, but still I was not confident. Still I kept on making mistakes, right? So it is very practice intensive because it is unconventional, okay? Differentiation is very conventional. It has got some methods. It has got some standard operating procedures, which if you know, you will be able to solve almost 90% of the question. But integration is other way around. It is very, you can say, it requires lateral thinking more than anything else. Okay. So these two topics will be taken in class 12. However, calculus doesn't end over here. You have application of integral calculus. You have application of integral calculus. Okay. Application of integration, what we call it. And you have only one application that is called area under curves. Area under curves. Now, how many of you, just I would like to know from you, how many of you are writing advanced placement calculus next year May or this year May? This year May, probably most of you would not be able to write. Probably 11th May, you will be able to write. 12th May, you will be able to write. How many of you are planning to write advanced placement? What is it, most of you asking? Okay, so advanced placement is basically, advanced placements are exams which basically students write to increase the weightage of their application to foreign universities. So what happens, let's say I want to pursue mathematics in, let's say, University of California, okay, or University of Texas. So now when I'm filling this form, they will tell me what are the criteria I need to meet in order to pursue mathematics in University of Texas. So some of the universities say that you have to write AP calculus for it, because AP calculus is a slightly advanced version of what you are going to study in 11th and 12th. So a person who has cleared AP calculus with, let's say, a score of 4 or a 5, so total score is 4, 5 actually, so then you have a better chance to get into that particular seat. Okay, so I think Prisham, I'm not getting your pronunciation right. So Prisham wants to write it. Anybody else? Okay. So you have to take this part very seriously, application of integration. So you will have more components added to it. You will have to study volumes of revolution. There is a washer method. There's a disk method. All those stuff will come into picture. Okay. Now, there is another chapter which I normally include in both of them, integral and differential, that is called differential equations. Ayyo, sir, equation is here also. Oh my God, I thought there were only algebraic equations. No, my dear, equations are not going to leave you. Okay, so you will be learning polynomial equations that you have already learned to a certain extent, quadratic equation, etc. They are polynomial equations. Soon trigonometry will be introduced. You will learn trigonometric equations. When calculus is introduced, you will learn differential equations also, right? So these are equations which involve know, derivatives inside it. Okay, we'll talk about it when the right time comes. So differential calculus, this part is going to be there with you in your undergrad also. Let's say you get into IITs, right? I went to IIT Kharagpur, and I remember my branch, electrical engineering branch, almost 2 years I studied differential calculus only. So there are different types of differential equations. 2 years I studied differential equations only. So there are different types of differential equations that will be coming your way. Okay, linear, homogeneous, variable separable, lot of things, right? So this is going to be there for you if you are actually trying to pursue pure sciences or pure, you can say, engineering later on also. Okay, so calculus is not going to end for you in 12th, right? So you are going to study more about it. So this is something which involves a mixture of both differential calculus as well as integral calculus, right? So this session is primarily to, you know, apprise you of how important calculus is going to be. Of course, we are going to learn some concepts also. So now today, hi Nikhil, I saw you. Nikhil was like, what is going on? Hello, Nikhil. So yeah, so today we are going to begin with limits, right? Because without limits, it's very difficult to understand differentiation. So limits is a precursor to differentiation. So let us understand limits today. Now, before I start, a quick disclaimer. Things may sound weird to you. Things may sound new to you. But keep your asking or wear your asking skills or question shoes on. Keep asking questions, because there are a lot of things which will be completely sounding weird to you. Okay, this is a disclaimer which I am giving you right now. It did to everybody who studied this course. It is not that you are studying it. It will sound weird to only you. I also, when I was in class 11, it all seemed, what is happening here? What is this? But yes, later on, I made sense of it because I asked right questions to my teachers. And thankfully, they were very, very helpful for me to understand this concept. Okay, so let's get started. So what is limit? Let me make this concept very easy for you. So first of all, I will write an expression in front of you. F of x, a function of x, and to the left of it I have written lim, and below it I have written x arrow a. Okay, so let me explain first of all what have I written over here. So there is a function f of x that the user will give me, okay, the question setter will give me, the teacher will give me. And next to it, I have written LIM. This is an abbreviation of, limits. ABV of the word limits. Many people will say, sir, limit itself is a very small word. Six alphabets are there. Why you want to make it even smaller? That's a style. Okay, people don't want to write limits. Okay, some people even do better. They write it as LT. That's another way of writing limit. Okay, but what is important here is to understand this guy. This chotu thing we need to understand. What does it actually mean? So this is to be read as x tending to a. X tending to a, or x approaching a. Okay. First of all, understood how to pronounce it. What is it? I will explain you. So how do you pronounce this? X tending to A or X approaching A. Okay, now let me give this as an example to you. So if somebody says X is tending to 2, what does it mean? It means that X is trying to come closer and closer and closer and closer and closer and closer to 2, but never attaining 2. Got it? What does it mean? X is trying to come closer and closer and closer and closer to 2, but never attaining 2 or never achieving 2. Are you getting my point? Okay, now let's say I have a number line. Okay, on this number line, no, it's nothing like asymptote. I will talk about it. On this number line, I have this number 2 sitting over here. Correct? So let's say a real number line. Okay, so since there's only one variable involved, I just took a single number line with for me. And when I'm approaching 2, okay, through this number line, I can approach this number 2 from two directions. I can approach 2 from this direction. Okay, or I can approach 2 from this direction. Let me use a blue color. Correct? Yes or no? So when somebody, let's say, there is a very small, you can say, path, okay? And you are standing somewhere in between. Let's say you are standing here in between, okay? Now, you know that to your left and the right, there are walls, right? Nobody can approach from there. So anybody can approach you either from this side or from this side, correct? Yes or no? So let's say this is A, you are A. So you can be approached only from this side or from the other side, which is what now I'm making it in blue so as to distinguish between the two sides, isn't it? So when you are approaching 2 from the left side, this is called the left side, okay? So what all values can X take when you are approaching 2 from the left side? So X can take something like 1.9. It can take 1.99. It can take 1.999. It can take 1.99999. There's no end to how many nines I can put. Correct? It can take 1.99999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999 you are approaching 2 from the left side of 2, these are the values of x that x can take. Okay? So normally, when we approach some number from the left side, we actually write it as x 10. Let me write it in white. So this is what we write as x tending to 2 minus. So this superscript, as you can see, basically says that you are approaching 2 from the left side of 2. So minus just says you are slightly less than 2. So minus doesn't mean minus 2. It just is a representative, or just is a symbolic expression that we use for conveying that I am approaching 2 from the left side of 2. Okay. Yeah, you can start. See, Vaishnav is asking, sir, can we start from negative side? Whatever you want to start with, it is basically where you are going. So I'm approaching 2. That is what I want to convey over here. Whether you start from 1.9, whether you start from 0, whether you start from minus 100, whether you start from minus 1 lakh, it doesn't matter. What matters is you are coming towards 2 from which side of 2? Left side of 2. That is what is mattering over here. Okay. So any question regarding this? I think Sharduli raised her hand. Sharduli, is there any question that you have, dear? Or is it addressed? You raised your hand a while back, probably because of mistake. You don't know how to raise hand. Okay. Anyways, now if you approach 2 from the right side of 2, then your x can take values like 2.1, 2.01, 2.001, 2.0001, 2.000001. So basically what I'm trying to say is that you are coming close and close and close and close and close and closer to 2, but from the right side of 2. And again, just to answer Vaishnav, you can start from anywhere you want. You can come from infinity also, doesn't matter. All it matters, you are coming towards 2. You are coming towards 2 from the right side of 2. Is it clear? Okay. Welcome to calculus, right? Things are sounding weird because you've never heard of these kind of things before, right? Okay, don't worry. Everything will make sense. But remember, guys, when you are approaching 2 from the right side of 2 or from the left side of 2, by the way, the expression for saying somebody that I'm approaching to from the right side of 2 is represented by X, again that tends to symbol, 2 with a superscript of plus. Okay, so again I'd like to repeat this. This minus doesn't mean minus 2. Okay, this minus is just telling you that you are approaching 2 from a lesser value than 2. So left of 2. 2 plus means you are approaching 2 from slightly higher value than 2 or a higher value than 2. I will not use the word slightly here. So that is just the representation for you. Okay. Now, irrespective of whether you are approaching 2 from left or right, you are never attaining 2. Right? So here note that X will never attain 2. That means X will never become equal to 2. It will come very close to it, but never become equal to it. Are you getting this point? So X tending to 2 or X tending to A, is this concept clear to you? Any questions? So far, so good at least, right? So whatever you have heard from me, itna to samajh mein aa gaya. Clear. Theek hai? Chalo, ab badhte hain. We'll go back to what is this expression? This whole expression actually. Okay. Now this whole expression means, or let me write it like this. Let's say this quantity is L. Okay, or let me write it as Li. Okay, let me write L only. Okay, so let's say this value that you are evaluating is L. Correct? So basically, this expression means as X starts approaching A, f of X will start approaching or achieving L. Is this making sense? Now see here. There is a function which is dependent on X. So we all realize that when X will change, my function will also change. Isn't it? Correct? I'll just take a simple example. Let's say I take an example of limit X plus 3 as X tends to 2. Okay. So do you all realize that as you change X here, X plus 3 will also get changed. That means your function will also change its value. Correct? Yes or no? So now I want to know that when X tries to approach 2, where does this guy, or to which value does X plus 3 tend to? Or to which value X plus 3 approaches to? That is what I am trying to figure it out. And that value to which it approaches is what we call as the L over here. Okay, the limit value. Are you getting my point? Right? Yes. Some of you have started giving the answer. Okay, we'll discuss it out. Don't worry. Let's go step by step. Okay. Now here, one question which baffles most of the student is, sir, you are still approaching 2. Whether you are approaching from the left side or whether you are approaching from the right side, your values of X are dynamic, isn't it? So let's say I'm approaching 2 from the left side. So I take 1.9, 1.99, 1.999, 1.9999, 1.9999. So there's no end to the nines which I can add. Correct. So this X is not a fixed value. It is moving. It is a moving value. Correct. It's moving towards 2. Correct. So whether you come from right side also, the same logic will hold true. So it is like 2.1, 2.01, 2.001, 2.0001, 2.0001, 2.0001, right? So it is moving towards 2. So when X is dynamic, it is moving, X plus 3 will also be moving. Correct? So this entire limits chapter is trying to address, if X plus 3 is moving, where is it going towards? Are you getting my point? So where it is trying to approach, or which value it is trying to approach, that value is the answer to this question. And that value is your L over here. Are you getting my point? Normally, I give this funny example. All of you burn diyas in your Diwali, right? Diwali time, everybody lights diya or candle at home, right? Now, let's say there is a diya, and let's say it is completely dark. you know, when there is a light source, all these insects and all, they will get attracted to it. I'm sure you would have experienced it also. So now let's say you figure out that there is an insect which has come very close to the diya. It is, you know, taking a turn around it. Okay. It has not yet fallen into the flame. But basically here, when it is moving around, you can predict what is going to happen to that insect. Yes or no? Can you predict what is going to happen to that insect? You will say, yes, that insect is ultimately going to fall into that diya and Ram Naam Satya. That insect will die, right? Yes or no? So you are predicting that it is going to approach its death. Even though at that point of time, it is still taking the circle around it. It is dancing around it, right? So at that particular time, you will not be able to say that. You will not be able to comment anything. But you know for sure that after 2 hours, 3 hours, or let's say in the morning when you get up, that insect would have fallen dead inside that candle or diya, whatever. Okay. So same way here also, x plus 3 is moving. But ultimately, it's going to attain some value. And that value is what we call, or it is going to tend towards some value. And that value is what we call as the limit. Shardul is saying RIP for insect. Okay. Now, this may all sound a little bit weird to you, right? Because you're not dealing with fixed values. You are dealing with moving values. And that's the, you know, a fun in calculus. Calculus is, we learn about, you know, changing quantities. The quantities which are continuously changing. Correct? That's the fun. We are not talking about stagnant things. We are not talking about static things. Okay? So now, let us evaluate it. Siddharth, sir, how can limit have a fixed value when value... Again, how does 2 have a fixed value? Right? So you asking this question is equivalent to you asking this question. When x is tending to 2, why 2 is a fixed value? X is moving, but it is moving towards a fixed value. That fixed value for the function will be called as the limit. Got it, Siddharth? Or should I explain once again? See, x is moving, but it is moving towards a value which is fixed. Correct? Similarly, f of x is also moving. And sometimes it will be stagnant also. I'll tell you the cases. Don't worry about it. So f of x is also moving, but it is again moving towards the fixed value. Are you getting the point? Just like x is tending to 2, 2 is a fixed number. F of x is tending to L, L will also be a fixed number. Got it? Is that idea clear? Okay. So just like that insect. That insect is still moving, moving, moving. By the time you watch it, let's say you watch it for 5 hours, 6 hours, 100 hours, it is moving, moving. But you know that ultimately, this fellow is going to die. Isn't it? So, that dying is a fixed stage. There is no change in that stage. So, this L is a fixed stage that this function is ultimately going to achieve or approach. Is this fine? Now, these things initially, they sound very, very weird to us. Okay, even it sounded weird to me because, you know, some quantity is moving and the other quantity is also moving, but still we say it is achieving or trying to go towards a fixed value. Okay, we'll figure it out. No, x is coming close to 2. It cannot achieve 2. For it to cross 2, it has to achieve 2. It will never achieve 2. See, let me just have a bit of patience. You'll understand a lot of things. Now see here. In order to evaluate this limit, okay? So what is this answer? How do I find it out? Let's take an approach, okay? By the way, this approach, we call it as informal approach. There's nothing in the name. Don't worry about the name. Okay? So I'm going to take an informal approach to find the value of L. Okay? All of you, please listen to this. So many of you would be thinking, then what is a formal approach? There's a formal approach also, but I'm not going to tell you that because you're going to get confused. Okay. See, you are as good as, you know, a person who is studying a particular thing for the first time. Okay. I don't want to tell you too many things because you will not be able to retain it. You'll get confused. Okay. So let's take baby steps. Okay. Let's take baby steps. Let's walk like a small baby, step by step. Now, x is approaching 2 here. So as I already told you, when you're approaching two, you could approach two either from the left side of two. And I also told you that we normally write it as x tending to two with a superscript of minus. Or you could approach two from the right side of two. Correct? So these are the two situations. So in order to distinguish between them, I have just put a line in between. Okay. Now, all of you, please contribute towards what I'm asking. If I am coming towards 2 from the left side of 2, what all values of x I can take, and what all values can x plus 3 take? That's my function. Okay. Now let's take some dummy values. Let's say x becomes 1.9. Then what will x plus 3 become? At that instant, 1.9. I'm not asking you a rocket science question. 4.9. Correct. If I put 1.99, what does it become? You'll say 4.99. 1.999, you'll say 4.999. Okay. Now you tell me, as you start going towards slowly towards 2, okay, but again, you are not approaching 2. So we normally write it as 2 minus. Okay. 2 minus. So 2 minus basically means you are in the very, very close proximity to 2 and to the left of it. Okay. So let me write this as a note for you so that you are able to, you know, remember this. When somebody says, I'll write it down over here. Note. I'll just write it down. When somebody says x is tending to a minus, you are basically in the, let me write it like this. Basically, x is in the neighborhood of a and to the left of a. Okay. So normally, let's say I take the example of 2 minus. 2 minus is 1.9999999999. You can keep on adding, you know, as many number of nines as you would like. So basically, when it becomes too big for us, in mathematics, we cut short that big expression and we write 2 minus for it. Okay. So 2 minus is just a shortcut of saying it is like 1.9999999999 on and on forever. So you can say 1.9 bar kind of a thing. Okay. So in maths, we don't, you know, write too many, you know, figures here. It looks stupid, of course, and we don't have time to write those. So in order to write that in a simple and straightforward notation, we say x is tending to 2 minus. So a minus is just a generic version of it. And when your x is coming very close to a, okay, let me write it as not tending to, I will say equal to, let's say. Okay. It means x is in the neighborhood of A. By the way, neighborhood is an English word which says in close proximity, just like your neighbors. Okay. They live very close proximity to you. So in maths also, we will use these words, neighborhood and all, even though it's an English word. So you are in the neighborhood of A and to the right of it. And to the right of A. Okay. So when you start approaching, values like 1.9999999, in order to cut short that too many nines, we will just write 2 minus. Okay. Now you tell me, where does this value approach? Where does this value approach? 5 minus. Exactly, Srijani. Exactly, Aryan. Exactly, Prishim. Okay, Setu. Absolutely correct. Well done. Okay. So now you realize that you are coming very close to a number, and that number is 5. Right? Now, let us do a similar activity. Let's do a similar activity here also. When I am approaching towards 2 plus. Okay. So here also I will take up some values of x. Okay. Just for our understanding. Let's say I take 2.1. Then this value becomes 5.1. I take 2.01, this value becomes 5.01. I take 2.001, this becomes 5.001. If I take 2.0001, it becomes 5.0001. Correct? So you realize that slowly and slowly and slowly and slowly and slowly and slowly you are moving towards, let's say, 2.001, which again I cannot write, but I will just write 2 plus. Let's say x becomes 2 plus, then this value will become 5 plus. Correct? Yes or no? Yes or no? Now look at these two instances and tell me, in both these cases, x plus 3 is approaching which fixed number? Answer is loud and clear. That fixed number is 5. That fixed number is 5. Absolutely correct. So this answer that you're going to write here is actually 5. Got this point or not? I'm writing it as big for you to understand this. Okay. Are you getting this point? Right? So please note, x plus 3 is not achieving 5. Neither in the left hand nor in the right hand. It is coming very close to a number. In both the cases, that number is 5. Okay, now here is something which I would like to add to this discussion. Let us understand few more things. So basically, I'm just building on whatever we have done so far. That's the beauty of bridge course. In bridge course, we start very slow. We start with, you know, absolutely assuming that you have no knowledge about anything. And we keep building on those. Okay. So in case you feel disconnected in any of the classes, I'm not just talking about maths, in physics, chemistry, please ask questions. That's how we will understand that you have not understood it. So Shardali has a question. Sir, when you said 1.9 bar, I tried to express in fractions. Exact value of it comes out to be 2. Oh yeah, that's basically 1.9 bar. You would have done this in class 10th also. It comes out to be 2 actually, but there's a difference between them. Okay. Anyways, let's talk more about this concept. So when you were trying to find out the value to which the function is trying to approach, when you were approaching 2 from the left side of 2, right, you got this 5 minus, isn't it? Correct. So we say that the left hand limit of x plus 3 as x tends to 2 minus is 5 in this case. Please note, 5 minus is not a fixed number, it is a dynamic figure. As I told you, 5 minus is 4.99999 written billion, trillion, zillion number of times. So it is basically a moving number, right? Till you add a 9, another 9, it is again a moving number. But when you say about a limit, limit is a fixed number. So when you're trying to approach 5 minus, we say that the left hand limit is equal to 5. Are you getting this? Okay. And here also, when you're trying to approach 2 from the right side, your function x plus 3 is trying to approach 5 plus. Correct? So we say right hand limit is equal to 5. So here we say right hand limit is equal to 5. Are you getting my point? Right? So limit is always a fixed number. Limit cannot be a moving number. Even though the function is moving, that's the beauty here. Even though x plus 3 is moving, either ways, whether left hand or right hand. But when you talk about a limit value, whether you're talking about left hand or right hand or your answer itself, it is always going to be a fixed value. Nobody can say limit itself is moving. Okay, limit has to be a fixed value. That's why it is called limit, limiting case. Okay, so now here, understand this. The limit answer that you wrote over here as 5, it is actually the same value that you got for your left hand limit and same value that you got for your right hand limit. So here is a new concept that I would like to add over here. Limit is nothing but the same value that left hand limit takes and the same value that the right hand limit takes. So unless until right hand and left hand limit values are equal, you cannot find the limit out. So limit is nothing but it is the value taken by the left hand limit and the right hand limit. So when both are equal, that value actually becomes your limit. So now a question will come in your mind. Sir, what if they were not equal? Then what will happen? We will talk about that. Now, even before that, a question would have come in many of your, you would be thinking, this 5 can only be obtained, can be easily be obtained if I put x value as 2 here. 2 plus 3 is 5. Why, sir, you did so much of drama and all, 1.9, 1.99, 1.999, and 2.1, 2.001 and all. Okay, so it may appear through this example that I simply took an approach which was not required. I could have just put this 2 value over here and I would have got the answer as 5, right? Now, that is not always true. Here, probably you got the answer by substituting, but that is not always the case. So I'm going to bust all these myths that you have by taking different examples. Okay. So two questions we have in our mind, which is still unaddressed. One question is, what if my left hand limit, right hand limit are not equal? Then what will be the limit in that case? That's one question that is coming in your mind. I'm sure most of you would be getting that question in your mind. And second question that would be getting in your mind, how is this answer different from finding f of 2? Correct? Doesn't it look like putting, value of x as 2 and getting 5? So how is it different from that? Let us try to understand these two questions through examples. So I will answer the second question before I answer the first one. So how is this different from this? So basically, let me write this versus, as if some match is going on, right? So this versus this. So how are these two quantities different? And when are these two quantities actually same, right? Because in the previous example, In the previous example, both the quantities were same. Just a second. Yeah, in the previous example, both the quantities were same, right? Right? So are they same always or they can be different also? Let us try to understand this. So for that, I will take an example. Let's say I want to evaluate limit x square minus 4 by x minus 2. Okay, so this is my function. And this limit I want to evaluate when x is tending to 2. When x is tending to 2. Correct? Okay, let's try to evaluate this. Now, now the limit exists, let me tell you that, Shardili. So now, the first thing that most of you who thought that f of a and limit of the function as x tends to a are equal, you will get a shock here because the moment I put 2 in place of x, I realize, it is giving me something which is undefined. Correct? But let me assure you, the limit of this function is a fixed answer. I'm not going to tell that answer. I'm going to evaluate it for you. Okay. So here, putting the value of 2 in this function did not work out. Failed. Correct? Right? So I'll tell you a very interesting story of my life. When I was very small, I was like around 5 years old. Okay. I had a driver. Correct, Setu. The answer is right, whatever I said. So let's listen to this story. I had a driver in my house who used to take me to school. Okay. And this driver was basically a very, you can say, expert in his skill. So whenever he used to change the gear of the car, I never used to notice that. Okay. I always used to notice him doing this on the steering. Correct. And one day I went to my dad and I said, why have you hired this person to drive the car? All he does is this. Even I can do it and I can go to school on my own. Then my dad said, okay, if you think this is how the car is to be driven, He took me to the car. So it was parked in the garage. So he took it out and he asked me to sit there. And he said, okay, you feel that the way to drive the car is just doing this on the steering. Try to do it. So he actually put it to neutral and all. I hope some of you know how to drive car. And he started the car. He put the ignition key on. And I started doing this vigorously. I mean, why the car is not moving? That's how my driver used to drive it. Correct? So basically what I saw is half the thing which he actually used to do, right? So there is something called pressing the clutch, putting the gear on, releasing it, putting the accelerator on, and then trying to steer the car through the steering. So what I saw only was probably 1/5 the activity which he did, correct? So when you saw that example, it gave you that haphazard knowledge that, okay, I can put a value in my function and get my answer of the limit. Right? But that was not the reality. Reality is something different. The reality is much more deep. So let us try to understand through this example. So you putting the value did not work out. It failed. It is undefined. But some of you are telling me that this answer is actually a 4. Okay. You are correct. How does 4 come out? We will discuss it. So let us take our informal approach. What was that informal approach? Finding the left-hand limit, right-hand limit values separately. So I'll take that informal approach. Again, I'm not going to answer what is the formal approach because it is going to confuse you a bit. So I'm not going to talk about it. Okay. So for informal approach, again, I'm going to take two scenarios. One where I'm trying to approach two from the left side and another where I'm trying to approach two from the right side. Okay. Now, let's take some values of x and let's figure out what does this guy achieves for those values of x. Same for this also. So x value and what does this guy achieve? Okay. Now for this, I would request you to have a phone in your hand which has got calculator in it. Okay. You may probably have a calculator already. If you have it, get it out. Okay. Now, I'm not encouraging the use of calculator here. It is just for you to solve this particular question so that we are fast. Okay. Now, let's take some values which are less than 2. 1.9. Let's start with 1.9. Okay. Tell me, when I put 1.9, what does this answer come out to be? So all of you, please take your calculator, put 1.9 square minus 4 by 1.9 minus 2. What does it give you? Arnav says it gives 3.9. I'll believe you, Arnav, because you're correct. Okay. Yes or no? Everybody gets that? Everybody gets that? Okay. Now put 1.99. What do you get? What do you get? What do you get? What do you get? 3.99. Thank you, Arnav. 1.999. 3.999. Very good. Now you must be appreciating and realizing over here that as my x becomes 2 minus, this guy will become actually 4 minus. Am I right? Arnav, I'll come to that, Arnav. Okay. I understand most of you are writing the factorization of x square minus 4. I'll come to that also. It is definitely on my cards. So if I ask you plain and simple, what is your left hand limit? What will your answer be? What will you say? 4, right? Don't say 4 minus. Okay. 4 minus is the value to which the function is, you know, going towards. But ultimately, limit is a fixed value, and that is 4 in this case. Okay. Is it fine? Any question? By the way, you should also apprise yourself of this notation, which I'm going to use, LHL. It's a short form of saying left hand limit. Okay. So it takes too much of time to write the whole thing down. Okay. Now let's come to right side of 2. 2.1, tell me what comes out. If I put 2.1 square minus 4 by 2.1 minus 2, what does it give me? You'll say 4.1. Correct? Okay. Shardili, exactly 4.1. 4.01. Correct. 2.001. Guys, you have calculators with you. You need to be fast. 4.001, correct? So as I move towards 2 plus, this guy will actually move towards 4 plus. And in such cases, we say the right hand limit becomes 4. is this right hand limit and left hand limit value equal? Are they equal? Yes, very much they are equal. And that becomes actually the limit value. So this answer is going to be 4. Are you getting this point? Are you getting this point? Now, some of you were suggesting this to me. Why don't you factorize it? Okay, I'll do that for you also. So let us understand that approach as well. By the way, is this clear how I got 4 as my limit answer, right? So now in your school or in your JE exam, they may also ask you separately for left-hand limit, right-hand limit also. So there can be a question where they can just ask you what is the right-hand limit, or they can just ask you what is the left-hand limit. Okay, so you should be aware how to find them. Okay. Okay, now let's come to what people were telling me on the chat box. Some people were saying, why don't you factorize this guy as x minus 2 and x plus 2? Okay. And why don't you cancel this out? And you are basically getting x plus 2 to deal with. Okay. Before I... Sir, when solving, do we have to find? Yes. Okay. In this case, or at least in the beginning part of your learning of limits, you have to do that way, Aryan. Later on, we are going to cut short a lot of, you know, unwanted stuffs, and we will get the answer pretty quickly. Okay. Now, here is a question, all of you. Please pay attention on your screen. I've written something very interesting. I've written that this expression is actually x plus 2. Is it correct? Is it correct? Very good, Arnav. Very good. Shardali, means this expression is always x plus 2? Pakka? Sure? Sure? Do you remember which teacher used to say sure? Sure? Always in your class 10th? Can anybody name that teacher? Send him a candidate. Ankur sir, yes. He'll say sure every time. Okay. Yes, my question is this expression always x plus 2? No, sir, not on Wednesday. Wednesday, it is not x plus 2. Correct, Prisham. Right. So this is a mistake which people do. This is x plus 2 only when x is not equal to 2, my dear friend. Not always. Right. When x becomes 2, you are not allowed to cancel 0 and 0. Remember, in maths, you cannot cancel out zeros, because if you do, then somebody can say, hey, this is same as this. Let me cancel zeros and I can say 2 is equal to 3. Ayya Rama, this is not possible. Correct? Right? Math is very interesting. You cannot bend the rules like this, right? So yes, I agree with the people who say it is x plus 2, but my dear, only when x is not equal to 2. If your x becomes equal to 2, this expression will actually be undefined. And that's precisely what happened when I tried to put 2 over here. Correct? Okay. Now, when x is approaching 2, anyways, I do not have any business with this. Correct? Yes, this is what most of you would be thinking. So, sir, why are you worried about x equal to 2, whether it is defined, undefined? I don't need that. I'm approaching 2 means I'm never achieving 2. You are absolutely correct. So, this is of no use to me. This is useless to me. Okay. Right? So, basically, you are trying to figure out where does... Let me draw the graph also for this. Let's understand it graphically. So, if I draw this function graph, let's say this is my function graph. Okay. So if I draw this function graph with respect to x, it is going to be a straight line. It's going to be a straight line like this. With a small change in this, there would be a hole in the graph. A very small hole I will punch at x equal to 2. Okay. So at x equal to 2, there would be a small hole in the graph. Now, why is that? Because as you can see, in front of you, I have written this function is undefined at 2. Okay. Hence, to show that undefined, nature of the function, I have to punch a hole there. Is it fine? Is this graph understood by everybody? Okay. Minus 2. I didn't get that enough. Why should I bother about minus 2? At minus 2, everything is fine. Numerator ko 0 hone do na, kya farak padta? Let it be 0. Denominator should never become 0. That is my issue. Right. Okay. So at 2, it becomes 0. It is fine. Let it be. Correct. But at minus 2, it becomes 0 here. But at 2, it becomes undefined. Undefined is a problem for me. 0 is not a problem. Function can become 0. No issues. Okay. But you should not become undefined. So undefined means I do not know what is happening to the function. So I have to put a hole there because it is not known to me. How is the function behaving? Gotilla. So I put a hole there. Correct? Now see here. When I'm approaching 2, I am approaching 2 either from the left side, okay, or from the right side. When I'm approaching 2 from the left side, let's say I take 2 minus. 2 minus, okay, probably will give me something here which is 4 minus. Okay, so let's say this is 2 minus point. Okay, and let's say this is, I'll use another color, 2 plus. So at 2 plus, okay, this will give me 4 plus, correct? So both these values are trying to come close to a fixed number, and that number is 4, and that 4 becomes your limit. Got the point? Okay. Now, in the previous discussion, I was avoiding telling you about formal definition, right? Formal approach of finding the limit. Now I'll tell you, sir, what did you just do? I just basically figured out that when I'm very close to 2 on the left of 2, my function is going to achieve 4 minus. Sorry, the minus sign got hidden by that arrow. And when I'm coming to 2 from the right side of 2, the function is approaching 4 plus. So we say that in such situation, your function is approaching a fixed value, and that value is 4, which is precisely the limit. Okay. So whatever is happening at 2 is none of my business. Whether there is a bomb blast at 2, I don't care. Whether there is an undefined happening at 2, I don't care. Okay, I'm just concerned with what is happening before 2, what is happening after 2, and are those two values which I'm getting for the function, they are basically approaching a number which is, in this case, number 4. And that 4 is your answer. Does it make a sense to you, Setu? Now, as I was discussing with you, I avoided something called the formal approach or the formal definition of limit. Now I'm going to tell you this, okay? Because this graph is there for me to, you know, support it. When you say limit of a function as x tends to a is a value, let's say I write it as value, what should I write? Let's say I write an L. What happened? Just a second, guys. I think just a sec. Somehow I lost that. This happens. Sometimes it happens. Show annotation toolbar. Oh, so let's say if you call this number as an L, okay, then there is a definition which is called epsilon delta definition. Okay, this definition says, if you're saying that the limit of a function as x tends to a is L, that means when the distance or the gap between x and a is a quantity delta, okay, where delta is tending to zero plus or a very small quantity, okay, then the gap between the function and L will be a quantity epsilon, where epsilon is also a very, very small quantity. Now, again, let's try to understand this through this diagram. So when this gap between your x value, let me just erase this part as of now. Okay, let me erase this also. Okay, now try to understand. So it says that at whatever x you are, let's say you are here, okay, and this is your 2 value. So when this gap is very, very small, okay, then the value of the function at that point and the actual limit of the function, this gap is what we call as epsilon, that will also be very, very small. Okay, so it is just trying to say that, it is just a formal way of saying that the gap between left hand limit and the right hand limit, in this case 4 plus and 4 minus, that gap will be almost tending to zero. If that gap is tending to zero, then the value to which these two left hand limit and the right hand limit are trying to go, which is 4 in this case, that will become your answer to the question. Okay. Now, this people find it very difficult to understand, especially a student coming from class 10th, right? This is mostly used in undergraduate. This is called the epsilon delta definition. Okay. So please do not, basically get disheartened if you don't understand this. What you know should be your informal approach, or what you should know is the informal approach. So don't worry too much about it. Let me write it down over here. Don't worry too much about it, okay? Because this is something which anyways you are going to see in undergraduate. Probably you will pass out 12, will go to a college. Most of you would be in IITs. There your professors will talk about epsilon delta definition of limits, okay? As of now, don't worry about it, okay? This is the first class of your calculus. I don't want to throw a lot of jargons at you. Okay. So just understand that till your gap between left hand limit and right hand limit, if this gap is almost tending to a quantity which is very, very small, okay, infinitesimal value. Okay. This, let me write it here, infinitesimal value, right? So that value of the left hand limit and or the right hand limit, that would become your answer. So in that case, your limit will become what was your left hand or what was your right hand value. Both are basically going to be, you know, same. So that is going to be the limit. So that is what this formal definition says. Okay, so don't worry about it. Now, the next question which we did not answer was, where is this gone now? Let me do one thing. I don't know how to save it. Some issue with this tool. I know you can see the screen. There's no problem with the screen, dear. The problem is with this tool. Okay, the problem is, yeah, now it has come. Yeah. Sometimes what happens, this toolbar below and the toolbar on the right, they disappear. Okay. And because of that, I'm not able to change the screen. Okay, now, thank you. Thanks for the patience. Now here, the second question, is there a chance that the left-hand limit and the right-hand limit are different from each other, right? And in that case, what happens to the limit? So for that, I would take a very unique function which probably you would have not heard of. Let me introduce you to something called the greatest integer function. Some of you might have heard of it, some of you may not have heard of it. So never mind, for both of these group of people, I'll explain this concept. Greatest integer function is basically a function which we represent by writing square brackets and writing something within it, writing a function within it. Now, if you see your graph and its transformation worksheets, towards the lower part, towards the end of the worksheet, I have started using square brackets. Some of you would have thought those square brackets are just normal brackets, right? They are not actually. They stand for greatest integer function bracket. Okay. Now, what does this function actually do? This function returns greatest integer less than or equal to whatever you have put inside. Okay. Whatever function you have put inside. For example, let's say I put 3.8. So tell me the greatest integer which you feel is less than or equal to 3.8. Of course, there can be no integer equal to 3.8, but I can find an integer or greatest integer less than 3.8, and that has to be 3, correct? Vaishnav, 3.799 is an integer for you. Okay, yeah, integer, my dear, integer. What do I need? I need an integer. What type of integer? There are so many integers below 3.8, right? There is 3, 2, 1, 0, minus 1, minus 2. But what integer I need? The greatest integer, less than or equal to 3.8. So that can only be 3 in this case. Got the point? Let's say 11.49. What do you think is the answer for this? 11. Very good. Now you have understood. Okay, tell me 0.00001. What is the greatest integer? 0. Very good. Okay, tell me -6.3. Now people have started making mistakes. This is -7. I tricked you all. Okay. Now those who are saying -6, my dear, -6 is greater than -6.3. -6 is greater than -6.3. But the definition says less than or equal to. So you cannot cite anything more than that. So the greatest integer, which is less than -6.3, is -7. Got the point? Okay. Now, why I'm talking about this function all of a sudden? Because I would like to take an example on this. Let's say I want to evaluate limit of the greatest integer of x when x is approaching 3 or when x is tending to 3. By the way, one small word before I move on. Whenever you see a square bracket, please note that unless until stated that it is a greatest integer function, please do not assume it to be. Because many a times square brackets are used just because there is a scarcity of brackets. Okay, so whenever such a question will come, you should always watch out for this word where this represents the greatest integer function, GIF. Okay, the short form is GIF, not the ones which you send on your WhatsApp and all. Okay, that is also a GIF, that is called graphic image format. But this is the greatest integer function. Okay, so in your worksheet of graph and its transformation, those brackets actually stand for GIF. Even though I've not mentioned it, I should have mentioned it, is my mistake. Okay. So my point here is, do not start assuming any square bracket to be GIF. Okay. So you should watch out for this particular phrase. Anyways, tell me what should be the answer for this. Very good. I'm getting answers from so many of you. Let's start working it out. Let's take our informal approach. So for informal approach, I would basically take these two scenarios, x tending to 3 from the left side, extending to 3 from the right side. Okay. Now, let's take x, gif of x, x, gif of x. Okay. We put dashes in there. Now, let us assume some values to the left of 3. Let's start with 2.9. What is 2.9 gif? 2. Just now you did some questions with me. Okay. What is 2.99 gif? We'll say says still 2. Correct. What is 2.999 gif? We'll say says still 2. Correct. So as you see, if I go to 3 minus, this answer will still be a 2. Correct. Right. So in this case, remember when I was discussing the definition, I said f of x may achieve also some value. F of x may tend towards L, but it may also achieve L also. In this case, it is actually achieving. So here, we can say that the left-hand limit value is 2. Correct? Now, the game is not over yet. We have to check out when it is approaching 3 from the right side of 3. So let's say I take 3.1. Then what will your answer be for GIF of 3.1? This time we'll say 3. 3.01? 3 again. 3.001? 3 again. If I go to 3 plus, this will be 3 and 3, nothing else. What did you see here and what did you realize here? You realize here that for the first time, the left-hand limit value did not match with the right-hand limit value. Correct? So here, your left-hand limit value, let me write it in red just to show that they're not matching. So here, left-hand limit value did not match with right-hand limit value. Then what should I do in this case? So in this case, my dear students, we say that the limit does not exist. So the answer to this question is limit does not exist. Okay. In short form, I will say DNE for it. Does not exist. Okay. So yes, now welcome to another, you can say perspective of limits. Limits may not exist also. So it's not necessary that limit should be found out for every function for extending to anything. Okay. So limit may not exist. Now, any questions, first of all? Let me just pause here for some time and give you an opportunity to ask this question. We'll talk about it, Shardari. That was next on my cards, actually. Okay. Meanwhile, here, any questions you have? Okay. Now, one thing I would like to add here. Please note that many people start blaming the function. It is this function, you know, this GIF function. Now I'm not able to find limit. No, it is not that. It is the whole situation to blame. That means because of this whole question, your limit did not exist. It is not because of the GIF function. So don't put the blame on the GIF function. So, I mean, I don't want you to have, don't stereotype this. Don't be like, okay, whenever there's a GIF, their limit will not exist. No, it is not like that. I'll give you another example with the very same function where the limit will exist. Let me give you another example. So let's not stereotype things. Let's evaluate limit of GIF as x tends to 2.5. Okay, let's see this. So now again, I'll take that informal approach. So I will approach 2.5 from the left side. I will approach 2.5 from the right side. Okay. So again, let's take some values to the left and see what happens to GIF. And same I will do for the right as well. Okay. Now let's take some value. Tell me a value which is very close to 2.5 and to the left of it. Probably you may start with 2.49. Correct? So 2.49 GIF. What is it, my dear? What is it? What is it? 2. Very good. 2.499. This is still 2. 2.499999999. Again, you say 2. So as you approach 2.5 minus, okay, as you go to 2.5 minus, this value will still be stuck at 2. Correct? Yes or no? Now let's take 2.51 on the right side. 2.5 plus part. So 2.51, 2. 2.501, 2. 2.50012. So as you go towards 2.5 plus, this will be stuck at 2. basically your left hand limit is 2, right hand limit is 2, and both of them are equal. And both of them are equal. So this answer is actually a 2. So here the limit is existing. So don't try to stereotype this, that, okay, this guy is a waste fellow. That will never give me a limit. No, it is not like that. It all depends on the situation. Getting my point? Now, is this the only situation where the limit is said to not exist? No, there's one more situation. We'll talk about it. That is what Sharduli was pointing out. Let us say, I ask you this question. What is the limit of 1 by x minus 2 square as x tends to 2? Okay, let's say I take this question. Why is limit called limit? Because it is a limiting value of the function. Okay, so that is a limiting value of the function. Okay, now let's try to solve this question. So when I take the informal approach. Okay, so let me approach 2 from the left side of 2 and let me approach 2 from the right side of 2. Again here, let's take some values and try to figure out. Here also I'll take some values and try to figure out this. Okay, now let's say 1.9. Now this quantity, if you calculate on your calculator, I don't know how much it comes out to be. It will be probably 100, I believe, something like that, 100. What is it? 100, correct? Yes, right? I hope I have not done a mistake in calculation. Okay. When you take 1.99, it will be like maybe 10,000, right? Oh my God, I have reached the end of the screen. Okay, anyways, if I go very, very close to it, this quantity will become very, very large, isn't it? So as I go to, let's say 2 minus, this quantity will become very, very large. Correct. Now, infinity is a number which is very, very big for us to express. Okay. Infinity is a number which is too big for us to express. Correct. So this number is infinity. So I have written a symbol for it. If I take 2.01, I'll again get 100. If I take 2.001, if I take a 2.1, I'll get 100. If I take a 2.01, I will get a 10,000. Okay. And if I start going towards 2 plus, this will again become a very, very large quantity. Now here, many people think, sir, this is same as this guy because you have written it as infinity, infinity. Guys, let me tell you this very straight away. Infinity is not a fixed number. Infinity is a dynamic number. It is too big for us to represent. That's why we use this symbol. Just because I've used this symbol at both the places doesn't mean they are same quantities. Right? Because they're not fixed. Both are moving. So your left hand limit here and right hand limit here, both are infinities. Okay? Both are very, very large numbers. But still, I cannot write the answer of this as infinity. We have to say it does not exist. Are you getting this point? Because infinity cannot be, limit cannot be a number which is already a moving number. As I told you, limit is always a fixed value. So it has to be a finite value. Are you getting my point? So this is another situation where your limit will be set to not exist. Are you getting this point? Are you getting this point? So it is not just because left hand limit, right hand limit doesn't match. It can also be because your left hand limit, right hand limit, both are becoming infinity, or both are becoming, let's say, minus infinity. Then also the limit will not set to exist. Okay. And the example that you gave me, Sharduli, in your example, Sharduli basically gave me a question, this. Limit 1 by x minus 2 as x tends to 2. Here if you see, your left hand limit will actually become minus infinity. Right hand limit will actually become plus infinity. And anyways, they are not equal. So this also limit will not exist. Okay. So my example was a much more confusing one, which people will get confused in. So I started with this. So to answer your question, they are definitely not the same. Correct? Infinity minus infinity are infinitely apart. Okay, so here left hand limit, right hand limit are not equal. But in this example, it may appear they are equal. So you may have a tendency of writing infinity. Please do not do that. Infinity can never be a limit. Okay. So we say limit doesn't exist in this case. So Shardhuli, are you there? Are you listening to me? Can you hear me? Does it answer your question, dear? Convinced? Okay, good. Now, before I move on, I would leave you with a quick recap of whatever I have done and one small question. So in today's class, what did we learn? Of course, we didn't do a lot of things because we didn't even touch upon differentiation. It's actually a far-fetched thing. Before we learn differentiation, we have to learn limits. So we first of all learned that if somebody says that there is a limit of a function as x tends to a is a value L, it just means that when x approaches a, your function will approach L, or at times it can achieve L. Okay, I've shown you both the situations, correct? Second thing we learned here was limit value should match with what you get for the left hand limit and what you get for the right hand limit. Okay, and this value should also be a finite one. Okay, that means if your left hand limit and right hand limit do not match with each other, okay, then we say that the limit does not exist. Okay, or even if your left hand limit or right hand limit become infinity or minus infinity, whatever, then also we say limit does not exist. Okay, so these are some things which we all need to keep in our mind. Okay, now before we close this today's session, which was a very interesting one, I would like to ask you to answer this question of mine. There is a function which behaves like this. It comes from 2, 2, 2, 2, 2. So this is basically y equal to 2 line. Okay. All of a sudden, at 0, this function becomes undefined at this place and comes over here. And again, it resumes back. Okay. So basically, it is like a... How do I compare this? Have you seen this heart monitoring machines? They'll go up like this, up like this, up like this. Okay. So this machine is like, it is coming, quick down, and then it goes up like this. Correct. So there's a quick, you can say, drop to zero, and again it comes back. So and then goes like that. Okay. My question is, what is the limit of this function? As x tends to 0. Let's see who answers this question, and I'll also give options to you. Okay. Option number A, it's 2. Option number B is 0. Option number C, it does not exist. And option number D, none of the above. Okay, let me put the poll on. If you are able to answer this question, I will think whatever I have explained to you, you have understood it. Okay, so please answer very responsibly. Else I will become very sad. People have not understood. Mm-hmm. Chalo, I have got two answers. Both are different. Anybody who's not able to see the poll, you can respond on the chat box. Okay, so Arnav, that last number you have written, is that your answer? Okay, Arnav. Sir, why are you smiling so much, sir? I'm smiling because I can't believe people are giving different answers. That's why I'm smiling. Sometimes I smile when I'm sad also. चलो जनता, 18 ऑफ यू आर देयर एंड ओनली 8 ऑफ यू हैव आंसर्ड. इट इज जस्ट अ टच एंड गो क्वेश्चन एक्चुअली, सो यू शुड टेक जस्ट 5-10 सेकेंड्स टू आंसर इट. Okay, in another 30 seconds, I'll close the poll. I would request you all to please press on the poll button or at least write on the chat box if you feel you cannot see the poll. Okay, last 15 seconds. Okay, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, go. Come on, 5 of you. You're waiting for something. Please answer. It's good enough time is given. Okay, anyways. 13 of you have answered this question, out of which most of you have said B, even though that most part is marginally most. So 3 have said A, 6 have said B, and 4 of you have said C. Okay, none of you went for D. Okay, thank God. None of you went for D. Now let's discuss this. When you're evaluating a limit, okay, you worry about what is the value that the function is tending when you are slightly less than that number, that is 0 minus, and slightly more than that number, which is 0 plus. Correct. So if I ask you, what is the value of the function when you are approaching this function from the left side of zero, what would your answer be? If you're approaching from the left side of zero, let's say -0.1, what is your answer? 2, right? Absolutely, Shardali. And tell me, what is the answer when you're approaching the function from right side of zero? What will answer be? What is the answer? That is also 2. Are they equal? Yes. So your answer to this limit is 2. Option number A is correct. Now, didn't I tell you that I do not care what is happening at zero or what is happening at A? In this case, your A is 0, of course, right? Whether there's a bomb blast, whether it is undefined, whether it is defined, I care. I don't want to use that word. I don't care. Okay. So you just have to watch what is happening just before and just after. And are those values sufficiently close to each other? Or are they value equal to each other? In this case, they're exactly equal, 2 and 2. So that value, 2, will become your answer. Are you getting a point? So most of you who said zero is because you were trying to basically, or your concept was basically stuck at the point that limit is equal to the value at A. No, it is not. They're different. We have already discussed it in one of the examples. Are you getting a point? Okay. So anyways, never mind. We will have more such opportunities. By the way, before we conclude this session, okay, I don't know whether we are going to